So this is the title of my talk. I am representing those two institutions, and the results are joint result with those people. Michał Horodecki is here in the audience, and I am in this comfortable situation that he can swap me, be a substitute at any random moment. So here's a motto, which is actually that tells us about that point that the laws of nature are still laws of nature, maybe represented by laws of probabilities. So how to work? The stops to work. Środkowy. Okay. And the laws of probabilities are still laws. So it means that even the randomness is subject to some laws, and especially it's very important to know how the randomness comes into nature scene, and this is quantum mechanics. This is one of the physical theories that tell us about it. And I will start from quantum mechanics then. And we know that we have a superposition principle due to Erwin Schrödinger. And we know that measurement actively changes the state of the polarized photon, for instance. And this is called the collapse of the wave function, introduced by John von Neumann as a famous von Neumann postulate. So imagine that we say, okay, we write the result of the situation when the photon passed the polarizer as a 1, and 0 when it didn't pass. Okay? Here is drastically the wave function has been changed. So quantum mechanics also allows more strange superpositions, the superpositions of two wave functions of the photon. And then if you perform the, in this particular state, which is called entangled state because it's not a product of the two wave functions, if you perform the experiments with the polarizers oriented in the same way, then we get the sequence of bits that are identical and are completely random. And you know, it's even worse, actually, in this popular picture. My talk will be very popular, up to the very end, I think. So the problem is that it may happen that the first photon already acquires its polarization due to the measurement, and the immediately the second one also has well-defined polarization, despite the fact that before the measurement, this quantum state, according to laws of quantum mechanics, was not defined. So suddenly, something happens here, according to quantum mechanics, that was not present before, despite this object has not interacted, apparently has not interacted with anything. And that actually Einstein didn't like it. And Einstein criticized the situation, saying that maybe quantum mechanics is correct but not complete. Maybe there is some underlying theory that really predefines the polarization of the photon or the state of the particle before the measurement. Individual particle, that's why we call it local realism, because it means that the local particle already has pre-existing values of the experiment. It carries its feature before the experiment. And this is the essence of the famous Einstein-Bohr controversy. And that's the famous paper from 1935 when quantum mechanics were challenged. Here we have the title from the New York Times, and Professor Anton Zeringer pointed out that this sounds a little bit bizarre. Scientists and the two colleagues. The main idea of the reasoning is that since one may remotely predict some property of a given particle without interaction with it, the property must have existed before the prediction. Sometimes it's called the EPR paradox because quantum mechanics says us the opposite. The axioms of quantum mechanics say, no, it didn't exist before. So the breakthrough, the discovery of John Bell, was first formalization of the Einstein's idea, which was local hidden variable model, which was just statistical description of the fact that each of the particle has pre-existing properties before the measurement. Second, Bell has shown that if EPR arguments were right, then the quantum mechanics should pass some special test. And this test is called, nowadays, is called Bell inequalities. And Bell was also the first who pointed out that quantum mechanics doesn't pass the test. So from that perspective, Einstein-Rosen-Podolsky argument was wrong, and Einstein criticism, in a sense, was not justified. The most famous Bell inequality, of course, everybody knows. This is, again, the same situation, but the polarizer is supposed to be at one of the two positions that are chosen randomly by each of the observers. And if the photons had the pre-existing value of past or being absorbed, it means that the photon just decides before at the very beginning has all the decisions made, whether it will pass or will be absorbed. And if we put plus and minus instead of photon will pass, photon will not pass, then of course that object, it's very easy to see it's smaller than 2, but quantum prediction, if we statistically perform many times, we perform that experiment with random settings, the average is 2 square root 2, which is bigger than that. Here is Alain Aspect, who was one of the pioneers of experimental testing of that inequality. Well, it has some interesting consequences for computer science and for cryptography especially. And I will call them quantum and post-quantum. And there is a difference. In quantum, this is called device-independent cryptography, which basically means that we have to trust quantum mechanics. But we do not trust the devices, do not need to trust the devices. In that case, Bell inequalities serve as a strong tester of entanglement. So we believe quantum mechanics, we just have special observable that tells us that the state is very entangled. In the post-quantum cryptography, we do not need to trust the devices, but we also do not need to trust quantum mechanics. As long as the theory we are going to put in place of quantum mechanics satisfies the natural condition that is consistency with special relativity, which means that it doesn't lead to faster than light telegraph. I will tell about it later. So here, Bell inequalities is not like, in the first place, the tester of entanglement, but rather a certificate of ontic non-existence of the properties before the measurement. So there are two, this role is much stronger here to be played. So first let's talk about this for a moment. So device-independent cryptography is the idea, the same experiment, but now we say, okay, if we believe quantum mechanics, we don't need to know whether here is polarizer or whether the device measures something else. As far as Bell inequalities are satisfied, the bits are random and they are far apart and nobody could know them. I will tell you why. Well, almost everybody knows why, but I will repeat it. So nobody knows it, so this is a cryptographic key because it's a randomness that is shared at a distance and nobody else can know that sequence of bits. Well, what's the origin of that? On the ground of quantum mechanics, it is because the singlet state is a pure state and as such it's extremal, which means it cannot be written as a convex combination of other states, unlike that one. And this leads for a so-called monogamy of quantum correlations. Monogamy of quantum correlations means that if two objects are maximally entangled, they are not correlated with any other quantum object. Well, however, as we know, Bell inequality violation guarantees that ontic non-existence of properties. So it goes far beyond quantum mechanics itself. And on cryptography, the physical cryptography, ground. Three scientists came up with the idea to use it. And this is the quote from Physical Review Focus, where we have the following sentence. Uncrackable quantum cryptography can thwart spies even if today's quantum theory is replaced by something better, as long as it remains impossible to send messages faster than light. Okay? So this is how it formally looks like. It's no signaling assumption, which means that in the same experiment we saw, we now don't know whether it works according to quantum mechanics or maybe some other theory, future theory, but that future theory we assume shouldn't have any, shouldn't lead to any correlations of setting of the device in one place with the outcomes of the other. Why? That's kind of obvious, because if there were some correlations, then by manipulating that statistics, which are settings of the device, the observer from here could change statistics here and send the message. Well, this leads us to formalization of those statistics, and they are called no signaling boxes after the paper by due to Sandu Popescu, Daniel Rohrig, Foundation of Physics in 1994. So they said, okay, we don't know whether this comes from the correlations come from quantum mechanics or not. We don't ask about physics that is behind it at all. We just put as a box, we understand the family of statistics conditioned upon the inputs, okay? If we fix the inputs, we have some probabilities of the outcomes A and B, but they have to be consistent. And the consistency here is provided by the no signaling conditions that are written here explicitly. There is some work has been done on the structure of those families of probabilities. So we may compare them with quantum mechanics. In what way? We just fix the number of measurements, take quantum statistics, and represent it as a family of probabilities. And in that way, we may say that for any fixed experiment, we may compare the no signaling statistics in, with quantum statistics. Of course, it's no signaling. We don't have faster than light telegraph. But it happens that no signaling statistics form a polytop, while quantum mechanics form the convex set, which is not a polytop. And in, here we have this classical local deterministic statistics that are represent the Einstein's idea, formalized by Bell. So looking at this, the question is whether quantum mechanics, how far quantum mechanics is from this set. And the first thing that is not very pleasant from the, as to, let's say it, not very pleasant from the perspective of this cryptographic scenario is that extremal points, the quantum statistics never is extremal in the set. So there is no chance that the set of quantum statistics will touch the extremal points. Here is the example. Once again, I'm walking around this most famous ball inequality. And it looks like this. The extremal point is here, quantum statistics is here, and locally realistic statistics is something like this. Actually, it's a reflection, the reflective figure. I could put a mirror, a picture down there. And immediately when we write down possible tables of the results, the object from here looks like this. This is the mixture of the objects of that kind, random mixture. Each of them has once in the position of rectangle. And this rectangle structure actually says that they do pre-exist. And the one means that they certainly pre-exist. Here we have this extremal no-signaling statistics, and we see that here is we have one half, which actually resembles perfect coin, perfectly random coin, and that's true. So quantum mechanics from that perspective is somewhere in between, and this is also reflected by the maximal value of Bell inequality that each of those theory can saturate. For local realistic, it's 2. For quantum, it's 2 square root 2, as I already told you. But for extremal no signaling, it's 4. So this also reflects the fact that quantum mechanics is somewhere in between. So we should remember that. The conclusion of this is that even if something looks perfectly random from the perspective of quantum mechanics,
it might not be so in future physical theory. Barrett, Hardy, and Kent somehow avoided that problem in some asymptotic, with some asymptotic trick. And eventually they got this cryptographic result. But this shows that it was not so trivial. So summary of that part is that neither quantum mechanics nor any post-quantum no-signaling theory is statistically compatible with quantum mechanics, even so, can be fully simulated in a locally deterministic way. Why? Because they are both above. They are both above that line. The interesting thing is that in both, in quantum mechanics and maybe in some future post-quantum no-signaling theory, spaces like shared randomness suddenly may occur. That's philosophically intriguing, but also has practical cryptographic perspectives. Well, so if Bell inequalities are so important, let's ask, have they been violated already? Has anyone shown that? Really, the value, experimental value, goes above the classical one. And actually, what are macroscopic assumptions on Bell inequality test? Okay, because we have experiments, so it's not about the particles, it's about devices as well. So the first assumption that, well, that's the way I think about it. That's the Heisenberg cut, which says that, okay, we have quantum mechanics or maybe some other theory. And in quantum mechanics, we have this continuity of evolution. And that's the realm of nature itself. But when we perform the measurement, we have discontinuity, and that's represented by this von Neumann postulate, which is completely unusual if you compare it to all the other postulates of quantum mechanics. That's my feeling, actually. So we have to make a jump from here to here. The origin of the jump is the, as everybody knows, is a subject of extensive research. And I will not tell about it because I don't know much about it, but it's definitely, there are ideas due to Roger Penrose and others that it's somehow related to the new role of gravity. There are three assumptions on the experiment that are fundamental. The first one is that the two labs should be space-like separated during the whole experiment. Okay, here is they are on the very safe side because I stopped the experiment here, but actually I could stop it here somewhere. Because the assumption is that no signal from light signal from here to there should be able to come before the experiment ends. The second is high efficiency of the detectors. There was a long battle to achieve high efficiency, but recently there are detectors that can achieve that in a low temperature, so that's no longer a problem. And the last assumption, which is popularly seen, free will assumption. And actually it says, you know, technically speaking, that both the experimentalists must have local sources of random bits. What does it mean, random? This is the Renato Renner, professor of Technical University in Zurich. This is his definition. But I believe it was, I mean, it's a very natural one, that random source is a source that emits the bits that are only correlated with its future, not with the past. Remember that correlations are reflective. A is correlated with B, B is correlated with A. So this is the definition of randomness. Random is something that can be only correlated with its future, which means that nobody could predict. Nobody could predict before what would happen. Okay, So the Bell inequality has been violated. The experiment showing that they are actually quantum mechanics does satisfy it. And here we have three papers in 2015, which eventually resulted in the article by Alain Aspect and the title "Closing the Door on Einstein and Bohr's Quantum Debate." So conclusion is that we have successful experiment that worked under those two conditions. But still, that assumption should focus our attention, because what it means that we have something like the source of unpredictable coin. And actually, it's not possible to prove that something like that exists in nature. It's always the assumption about the physical theory that would provide us this. And this is so-called the super, well, let me just mention one thing more about this free will. Obviously, this is the colloquial name of this assumption, because obviously we know that free will is not equivalent to randomness at all, and we know obvious counterexamples on both ways. Technically speaking, we need something like ontic randomness, which is fundamental non-predictability. But it's related to so-called superdeterminist problem, because we want to show that quantum mechanics is random. Well, for instance, in this cryptographic problem, but also, and more fundamentally, in this Einstein-Bohr debate to support Bohr. But to prove randomness of quantum mechanics, one needs a priori of randomness already. So this resembles a little bit those claims of Barnhausen that he had saved himself from drawing by pulling on his head. So, we have to assume that the observer has some unpredictable elements while testing quantum mechanics. And that might be end of the story, actually. But let's ask more subtle question. Suppose that we have to assume something about the access to randomness, but let's make this assumption as weak as possible. There is a formal mathematical description of weak source of randomness, and this is, mathematically it's written here. It's called Santavasirani resource, published in that paper, seminal paper in 1984. Mathematics is a sequence of bits that condition upon their past. They are almost determined, but almost. So condition upon the past, they're almost predictable, which means with 1% of uncertainty. Conceptual, it's a kind of coin. We can imagine that we have some coin that, because of some new laws of physics, has some ontic randomness, very little one, but very weak one, but actually ontic, which means that no physical theory could predict with 100% what will happen. With 99%, yes, with one, not. Of course, we, looking at this, we would evidently see that it's not random, okay, because we have a lot of zeros and only two ones, but there might be more sophisticated sources of that type. And suppose that that we have two coins of opposite bias, and we toss them, but we choose the coin according to the binary expansion of pi. Obviously, it would look very random. And at the same time, it's not random almost at all, because binary expansion of pi is deterministic. So the question is that we may have sources that look very random, but this ontic randomness there might be very weak anyway. So Miklós Santa and Umesh Vasirani put the following problem. Is it possible to amplify the source, very weak, using deterministic classical computer methods of computer science. And what we would like to have that would be fantastic would be like this. We have this weak source, which has big bias. This epsilon is big. And we just, by processing it, we remove that bias, getting the perfect randomness of ontic character, which means that this is given by fundamental laws of nature. It's very weak. But after post-processing, we would get something that is perfect. And there is no go theorem. It's actually stronger. It says that even the slightest improvement is not possible. This is the result of those two people from 1984. And now the question comes, OK, what about if we have quantum physics instead of classical computer? But we have very weak source. Can we still prove that quantum mechanics cannot be simulated by local deterministic theory? It means, can we refute Einstein's criticism under such difficult circumstances? And the second is, can we amplify that weak randomness according to this picture? Instead of classical computers, now we have laboratories performing quantum experiments. This is the question Renato Renner and Roger Kolbeck posed in 2012. Well, the idea would be like this. We have this Santa Vazirani source, very weak. We don't know its origins. We just believe that there is a one, very weak one. We have the labs that are spatially separated. These correlations look quantum, as we have in lab. We don't know about correlations with some other parts of nature. It may be eavesdropper if it's computer scientist scenario, but it may be some part of physical universe that subjects to laws that are not quantum mechanical laws. Okay? From its perspective, it might be that what looks here random, as I told you already, might be not random. Well, there are some technical assumptions here, which one is that this and this is probably not possible to avoid, is that during the experiment, Alice and Bob keep those bits secret, which means that they keep them in the lab. There is no leakage. Here is yet another picture of that. So we have this weak source of randomness. We have the source of correlated particles. Alice and Bob perform Bell experiment, and eventually they may meet. They may exchange the data, and they get the bit that is almost perfectly random. Okay, so the question is it possible? So the first result was by the authors that posed that question, and they said yes. But if one assumes perfect measurements. And that's the problem, because we do have finite measurement error in experiments. And the input should be weak, which means that this bias not very weak. So this means that the bias shouldn't be so big. Actually, this bias should in this paper is kind of small. It's around 1%. In other authors, 1 year later, proven that yes, it is possible to amplify arbitrary weak randomness, but you have to assume perfect devices and you have to access unbounded number of devices. So this is something that we, from perspective of the experiment, we shouldn't accept, right? So finally, the problem is, can we just skip this place in between the haribda of fragility of noise and still of unbounded technical resources? And we managed to prove that for a few devices and for experimental error tolerance. Recently, we also modified it for some minimal assumptions on the quantum mechanics that it has to satisfy. So the answer is yes. Under realistic conditions, you can do that. Of course,
the result very much depends on the and the duration of the experiment very much depends on the degree of bias we want to eventually remove. So should I finish? I have like 3 minutes more. So maybe I will say just a few words about technicalities. So it's based on the special Bell inequality. It's about four photons, local observables, just as before. They may be represented by poly operators. The interesting point is that at this case, quantum mechanics is on the boundary of no signaling statistics. So it doesn't contain any locally deterministic component at all. And here is the Bell inequality written in this computer science jargon. I don't think it's reasonable even to explain that. But anyway, there is Bell inequality. And now the problem that we encounter is the following. First, is it possible to prove that this inequality is broken by quantum mechanics? So we have zero or something close to zero instead of two, having very weakly random settings. And the second really shows the problem here. Because that Bell inequality has a very nice property that quantum mechanics is on the boundary. But at the same time, it has from the perspective of generating randomness, it's kind of weak. Because if we have even perfectly random settings, the outcomes are significantly biased. So in that sense, we need something more than opposite, because we need very biased inputs and perfectly random outcomes. Okay. So it really looks like, you know, a little bit tricky to problem. Eventually, we managed to do this, and here is the formal idea. So we have the post-quantum no-signaling box that we assume here that is extended by this new physics, maybe this eavesdropper or this environment that might be, I don't know what, dark matter. And the marginal should look like quantum mechanical description of quantum mechanical experiment, okay? This extension is something dangerous. And we have the SV source, and we repeat experiments many, many, many times, okay? And we use classical randomness extractor, okay? And what was the crucial element of the proof was to prove that the following quantity goes to zero with n exponentially. So if we have the probability of acceptance, which is probability of saturation, the Bell inequality up to some error, we run the test of Bell inequality, and we say, okay, we accept it with if the error is not bigger than delta, and provided that we accept that, we should prove that the distance of two probability distribution goes to zero. What are they? The first is just our final random bit that we want to have ontically random. The second is all the environment that is of unknown physical nature, as I told you. That might be this quantum gravity from the perspective of which quantum mechanics might, in principle, not look random. And this distance going to zero means that this our random bit becomes completely uncorrelated and uniform statistically. So this formula implies that we have this nice property of this randomness against all those unknown physical, you know, statistics of unknown physical origin. Here is the formula for this, actually. It's more complicated. And the idea of the proof in a simpler variant is to apply Azuma-Hövding inequality. Well, this is the martingale theory that allows to include the memory of the device. Because, you know, if you run the experiment, of course, you use the same device, but it may have some memory. And this is to take into account that. The semi-definite programming is for defining this threshold, actually. And the amount of randomness, this biased amount of outcome randomness that we start with.
There is so-called mean entropy source. Eventually, we use that. So we prove that somehow the sequence of outcomes should satisfy this. And we apply random extractor. So the simpler version of this, the experiment, would look like this. I mean, in this box representation, here's this SV source, this Santa Vazirani source that is weak. Here we have four labs with photons. This means that they are space-like separated. And we run it many times. So time goes down this way, not up. So we run it many times, and we take the results. And then we first check the Bell test. If it accepts, if no, we abort. We say the experiment failed. But if yes, then we took the outcomes and combine it with this weak ontic randomness on the extractor. There is a more complicated form of it. This is because the extractum we used first was very weak. It could only give you one bit of the random bit. So to have more, we have to use this. When we pick random, we have four devices in one space-time location and four devices in another space-time location, but they are space-like separated here and here as well. And here, the experiment takes much longer, and we pick up randomness on a bunch of the results. And for this, we have to use some modification of the finitude theorem, which looked like this. And this is adapted to the specific statistics of the devices. I don't want to explain all those details here. But eventually, the answer is yes. So there is an intriguing alternative. There may be no ontic randomness in the universe at all. But if there is a very weak one, then the nature has no choice. It really has to assume, to admit ontic randomness in its arbitrary stronger form as well. So that's putting to the extreme question of how much we need to prove that quantum mechanics is random. And definitely, quantum mechanics plays here the role that no classical theory can take. So conclusion, my conclusion, which is a little bit, subjective, but it's like this. It seems that it's more likely that there is some randomness in the universe rather than that there isn't, okay? Because it survives under very, very weak assumptions. Okay, there are more questions. First is what could be this source of this ontic randomness? And here, Anton Selinger group the collaborators proposed this idea. But of course, one that may debate that, because if there was Big Bang, everything at the beginning was, at the same point. There were no space-like separations. So. But of course, that's an idea to put the test to the extreme. Of course, one may ask more questions around it. Of course, one of them is to make very careful what it means causality, especially in all those quantum information perspective, which usually, as you have seen, is based on non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So here, we have some ongoing work. And finally, is there the role of conscious observer necessary to such an amplification or not? I provided you the very active protocol, right? But we have observers. They have to do a lot of work. Is it possible that this type of process is a natural process somewhere according to some new laws of physics? And of course, it reminds me of the John Barrow principle saying that any universe simple enough to be understood is too simple to produce a mind possible to understand it. So let me eventually show the place where most of work was done. It's here. Founding entrances are here. And here are the people that are working in the place. And
with that, I would conclude. Thank you very much for your attention.
About in the 1950s, when I was thinking about spin networks, and I had to distinguish between probabilities due to ignorance and probabilities that were inherent in the quantum formalism. And the case that I considered was if you have two spin half particles, it's more general than that, and you want to know, you know, and they come together, do they find themselves in a singlet or a triplet state?
Okay.
Spin zero or spin one. And but you don't know, you know, maybe the apparatus was set up in some way that involved these being information about it. So the way I would set it up is to have two EPR situations. Each of these particles were produced by an EPR pair.
Yes.
And so the rule was that the other one of each pair they just went off into the future. And they were not allowed to come together, and so that the probabilities were then the pure quantum probabilities in this case.
Yes, I see that. Right.
And but if of course somebody came along and compared the other pairs, then that of course would be cheating.
Yeah.
So it's a question of the future being. Uh-huh. You're not supposed to know what's going to go on in the future. Sorry, you were going to say something.
Yeah, I just want to comment on that because actually this idea was in Zurich. People in Zurich used this to prove stronger version of cryptography. So I will ask you for the reference for that because you know, it's sometimes that something is being rediscovered after 30 years or something like that. Actually, they did something like this in this device-independent cryptography. So the idea also was to have those two singlets and put the particles together, you know, here and having this kind of certified randomness. But of course, it doesn't avoid that problem. That problem. I will just come. Oh, that problem, you know, because here. If we believe that singlets are one, that quantum mechanics is fundamental, we know that it's perfect. This is perfectly random. But if there is maybe some future theory,
yeah, sure.
that it's not no longer so random, so because we might be here. So this, but I would like to I will ask you for the reference because we should somehow, you know, refer in from the historical perspective because I didn't know about it.
I'd have to look it up because the. There were write-ups of sort of part of the spin network theory in various places, but the complete theory wasn't ever written up. And in my collected works, there is not. I tried to finish the paper, at least to see where the paper was going. I don't think it affected this argument. I think that part of it is written up in various places, so I can dig up references for you, yes. But I'd have to look at them to make sure. It was an important point to distinguish what one might consider pure probabilities that come from quantum mechanics, and I call those pure quantum probabilities, and those which depend on lack of knowledge. And it's a bit of a grey area when you have complicated systems, because the idea is you build up the geometry by working out the angles between spinning objects and from the probabilities.
Yeah.
And then if there is previous information exchanged, then of course that would give you entanglements between these two states and so on. And these issues were very relevant to the whole discussion. Mm-hmm. But I'll try and dig up.
Thank you very much.
For you. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Maybe let me make a link with Michael's talk and let me ask you and Jurek, how about randomness in a different compos? Is there maybe a place for some epsilon randomness there?
Yeah. Yezu, can you say something about randomness?
I can try. The question maybe would be the following. Whether anybody consider changing of model of set theory during, say, quantum measurement or whatever. Because possibly the calculation of statistics could depend on model. The general question is whether maybe you know about some approaches to this kind.
Frankly speaking, that's a question to Marek Kusz, probably, Professor Marek Kusz is in the audience actually, because to my knowledge, those approaches were more like on logical perspective. So before asking Marek what he would say about this, I would add something saying that it seems to me that there is potential for category theory at this point. We exchanged some informal remarks on that. I think when you ask about final, I'm sorry, I couldn't switch here. We did some work on this and it's not set theory, but it's the theory of correlations that look a little bit different. And it seems to me that for this you need some abstract approach because they are not natural. They are not natural. They look like, I don't know, it's like combination of Bohmian mechanics with quantum statistics. It doesn't look very, you know, from that it doesn't look very familiar to anybody. So the question is maybe category theory would formalize and maybe would even say that it doesn't make sense in that formalism. That would be some hint. Right? If it doesn't go well with the well-defined mathematical formalism, then it's a signal that we should probably change something. But I would like to pass the question to about this new maybe set theory description to Professor Marek.
Okay, so what I can say, so our approach was really logical, so we tried to understand why it is possible that that quantum mechanics is capable of producing some randomness in comparison with other theories. For example, with this classical theory or this post-quantum theory of non-signaling theories. And rather than to prove that quantum mechanics is really produces randomness, to understand why it is possible. Okay? Uh-huh. And this was this logical approach in this series of papers. And then we translated this in a sense in a categorical language, just not to work with quantum logics per se, but rather to translate it into some intuitionistic logic. Okay? For all this, especially for this post-quantum theories. And this is, I think we succeeded, although I don't think that I can say why it is so and what theories are capable of producing randomness and what are not, which are not. Mm-hmm. But at least I can say why this extreme non-signaling, okay, this which produces the from the point of view of Bernoulli qualities of CHC, as inequalities, the strongest correlations, one they are probably not capable of producing randomness, okay, just like classical theory, but quantum mechanics is capable, okay? And so our goal is actually to identify this theory in which this is possible. The program, okay, obviously it means that you have to have some good definition of what is closed quantum mechanics. As you know, quantum mechanics is resistant to small improvements.
Oh, yes.
You cannot improve it very weakly, yes, because you immediately bump on some real obstacles and something which definitely contradicts I would say more fundamental principles than quantum mechanics itself. But in a sense, you can define in some sense this approximation to quantum mechanics, and just our program is to see when it really happens that some theories are random and some are not. Okay. There is definitely still missing, and I don't think that you can produce something like that, a proof of this kind. Okay, so to obtain this fundamental result, as far as I understand, that either everything is deterministic, or if there is even the tiny amount of randomness in the universe, then there must be completely random processes. Okay, this is the thesis of your talk, actually.
Yes.
So this we cannot reproduce. I don't know. This would be a nice goal, either in this quantum logic approach or in this category. I can only advertise our papers.
One comment also. I'm aware of two papers of Paul Benioff from 1976.
Uh-huh.
He showed that under some definition of randomness, you have to change the model of set theory. Thermal Frankel set theory.
Oh.
Right now I record it.
Sounds very interesting.
Yeah, it was freshly, it was in with cooperation with Solovey, who worked in forcing set theory.
Oh, I see.
It was quite interesting.
Right.
And I remember that under some definition of randomness, one has to change model of set theory, and you cannot express quantum mechanics in a single model of set theory, neither in any of its forcing extensions. It was the main idea of the question. So maybe that would be some indication.
I have a question actually to your approach to natural numbers. So could you see something like, okay, so there are many non-standard models of arithmetic of natural numbers, or there are non-standard models. So how it fits to your picture? Okay, so could you identify this in a sense?
Very good question, because
okay.
There are indeed many non-standard models of Piano arithmetic.
Yes, exactly.
Which is first order
yes.
formal theory, and but still they are classic. They are not intuitionist.
Yes.
And in Basel, of course, what Michael discussed, there are non-standard numbers, but on the other hand, you cannot use ultra-filter construction
mm-hmm.
because it is
mm-hmm.
It requires axiom of choice.
Okay. Yes.
So what you do, you can use filter construction.
Uh-huh.
Because Frechet filter sits in every ultra filter. And the advantage of this approach is that you have unique Frechet filter
uh-huh.
corresponding to every non-standard
uh-huh.
extension of
uh-huh.
Classical natural number.
Uh-huh.
So this is, I would say, more economic.
Uh-huh.
Probably, I have only the comment as we discuss it. The origin randomness, we know that there is an attempt to define in terms of complexity, like Kolmogorov, Solomonov, certain approach, yes, is something will define randomness, but this method is ineffective. We cannot calculate, we have a good definition in terms of programs and so on, but the problem is that there is this method approach is not effective. It does not introduce something new in this sense, operation sense. Yes, this is because this is very nice. The idea is complexity, Kolmogorovian and post-Kolmogorovian, the quantum a la Joza approach, quantum. Complexity. Vitani et al. Is some more general approach, but still is on the passive level, yes, in this sense that we cannot to produce any results, interesting results.
Yes.
So you say that some programs may look very promising, but they, instead, except the formalization, they wouldn't give the results. So of course, that's always the risk in science. Right? Nice. You
know. I'd like to advertise a big bell test. So our colleagues want to run bell tests where the settings. In this lecture, we know that the settings should be random, and from where you can take randomness. So one idea is that people produce randomness, and so there is online online webpage where you can put your settings, and especially you can take it from your kids, grandkids, ask for a number and put there, and then there will be experiment. I think maybe it's like online, you put the number and then some device does it. So perhaps it's like that, I didn't know. So big bell test, this is the phrase to Google.
But doesn't this assume that our minds are not algorithmic?
So when I put several numbers, can you say how random I am? Yes. How, if I put several numbers to this device, okay, so I put a series of numbers.
Ah,
so can you tell how random I am?
No, but no, because because that's precisely where we have to assume, yes. So it's not to test our randomness, but it's just to fill this gap with by assumptions that we are random, people are random, they produce random things.
If I would like to ask some question to Professor Heller, which is related to this category theory of natural numbers. So, as far as I misunderstood something in the history of science, but as far as I remember, there are those limitation theorems that say that some definitions, if they are too precise, they may give different models with different intuitions, actually. So that something that we may have a theory that satisfies the natural numbers axioms, but it looks different. So the question is, from that perspective, is it possible somehow to, not to avoid, because it's not possible, but at least put new perspective on this limitation theorem and intuitions that are behind axioms? Because it's always about intuitions, right?
Well, I think that the important thing is that when you are in a given category, then the gap of arithmetics could be weakened. And this is a window through which we can weaken also the limitation theorem constraints.
I have to think about it.
Okay, this is more or less the problem of the non-standard models of arithmetic. So I think that some of these models are excluded by this approach. I don't know if you agree, yes, but it definitely does not define, it does not mean that the only model of arithmetic is the one you are thinking of.
But we have to live with that.
Yes.
I remember that we discussed about some attempt to derive some randomnesses from meta level, meta theory from non-commutative geometric approaches. Is it something like?
Is it not commutative geometry? It's quite another story. Namely, some results of non-commutative geometry suggest that set theory is not enough for the fundamentals of mathematics. For instance, if you assume, well, I must remember to be correct, that you use only transformations,
are measurable, then there are some entities, some structures in non-commutative geometry in which the functor of belonging to a set loses its meaning. Mm-hmm. And then this is a suggestion that set theory is not enough. Yeah. I was once asked Alan Cohn about that because he mentioned that result in his book. But he said that everything he knows about that he has put in this book. So I did not get an answer. But I think this this point is very important, and some pure mathematicians should take it and elaborate that. Yeah. In which sense set theory is not enough for non-commutative geometry?
Yeah. About causality, because you advertise something about causality. From this kind of investigation we made, it's also clear that quantum mechanics is also somehow singular from the point of view of the structure of entangled states. Basically, you don't have entangled states. And also on the, I would say, this post quantum theory, the entangled states are also a little different than this. Mm-hmm. But this is interesting because concerning causality, there is this idea which I think is not so young, but not so fresh, but somehow now it's investigated by Bruckner, for example, that you can use the causal order in quantum mechanics. So the causal order of events in quantum mechanics can be conditioned by the by quantum mechanics itself. Okay? So this you need in entangled state because the most simple model you can imagine is you can imagine two laboratories and they can send photons just from one from A to B or B to one. A direction in which we send is conditioned by some state of some mix, okay, so it is entangled with some other
degree of freedom.
Well, to degree of freedom, which is in the state which is not a product state, okay, which is so this is a superposition of some states, okay? And then you decide upon measuring this, you decide about it. So this is definitely something which is very hard to imagine in classical state because you can consider this, but you do not have superpositions. So, can this have some importance for checking or proving also the randomness? Could you imagine that it would have some?
Okay, so I think I should ask you then to
present our statements because we are looking at this.
Okay, very nice.
So it's a kind of ongoing work here. We are now considering and
so
somehow.
I'm also thinking about that.
We don't still have the ultimate conclusion, but as far as we can see right now, with what the group of Bruckner says, that's a bit of a cheating.
Uh-huh.
So it's all about the definitions, what you call an event and what you call a causality.
Okay.
For a relativist, an event is just a point in space, right?
That's true. So I would say that extending this to the relativistic physics, I also think it's questionable because I don't. Okay, so this is analogy of words, not an analogy of events, I would say more. But the fact that you can produce something in quantum mechanics, as for quantum mechanics, not from relativists, but from quantum mechanicians, I would say, is fascinating, and it could be some way of investigating also this kind of.
I agree with you that it's fascinating because we try to understand some sequence of papers of Oreskov, Bruckner, and so on, to understand and we fight. Yes, we did not.
You are in the better position because you are a group and I am a single point.
Witness, for example, mathematics, witness of causality, yes, something like this for us completely.
You can also develop probability theory in some categories where the spaces have no points. So from that point of view, it is even independent of this.
Let me continue on this point, because I remember I asked you once whether you have this some theory that regions would play the role of points, okay? And I understand that would be the situation, like that I may map the whole regions into some objects that are not points but are real, right? Yes. May I think about this like that?
Yeah, it's more simple. I mean, you can define topology as a category without mentioning points. Topology.
I think this is also an idea of Tarski.
Yes, of course. He knows
very. Yes, he knows it very. So there is a paper of Tarski about algebra of topology.
It's intuitionistic.
Yes.
Topology is an algebra of intuition. Yes.
Nobody spoke at that time about category theory.
We should better read much more than we read before starting scientific work. I'm thinking about myself.
Yeah, you would never start your research.
Your point about probability without events, without points, also reminds me of some, say, radical quantum field theory approach, saying that, well, after all, what we have are the correlations. And we have just local algebras of observables, but these are just algebras. I mean, just observables, but you can think that this is the... Usually you're constructing starting from the space, but you can imagine that you just start from the algebra. That's something global. You don't have any space-time.
Of course.
So it's
you can do something with this, but it is not necessary.
Yes.
It depends on the intervention.
There are also some generalizations of the probability theory in quantum geometry. So the so-called free randomness, free probability theory, in which the object to which you apply such a theory need not to have any points. So it's a non-local theory from the very beginning.
I remember I read a paragraph in your book about philosophy of chance, philosophy of chance. Yes.
Non-locality problem into our yesterday evening discussion. So maybe that's a question for you. We can imagine a theory that which is completely deterministic, but to determine the whole evolution, you would need to somehow transgress the whole universe, you know, every single state, every single thing. But then if you just restrict to any compact subset of space-time, mm-hmm. in a compact region of space-time, then you effectively have a theory that is, say, epsilon run, right? And then you can amplify it and so on and so on. Mm-hmm. So could one, say, strengthen these results in this way that you can have something completely deterministic, but you would have to have an infinite knowledge.
Uh-huh. Okay, so from that perspective, that I have two different associations going from completely to different region directions after your question. So first, from that perspective, this would be completely deterministic because we have this unbounded expansion of this environment and we put everything there. Mm-hmm. So if we, and actually as resources, we have two extra physics here, okay? We have one mechanics and we have this ontic randomness, and this is some extra physics that we don't know. And we have this environment that we discovered, there's also another extra physics like dark matter, say. So if everything is deterministic, then you have this precious circle, you wouldn't get out of it. But of course, it seems to me that sometimes you may prove some things indirectly. For instance, that was rather philosophical thing that we published a paper saying that, you know, sometimes it's better to think about quantum mechanics as a real thing rather than Copenhagen perspective. Because if quantum algorithms are really true, if Schwarz algorithm is true, then you cannot describe the system effectively. Which basically means that as a difference between Copernicus and Ptolemaeus, that there is one description that is really, you know, very concise, and you have the structure. And you have another description that is complete mess, or it's even, you know, impossible to imagine how to do it. So in that way, I would say like this. Then you should put something like a pragmatical Occam razor, which is not ontological one, because you couldn't do that. But that you say, okay, I may say that it's more likely. The one thing is more likely than another. But obviously going along this direction that you pointed out, I remember a discussion with my student who said, sir, if we do not assume something, do we assume that it doesn't exist? And of course the answer was no, because the not assuming the axiom is not assuming its negation. So I would stick to this pragmatic Occam razor and say that ontological questions are those that we have to live with. But we may, as Imre Lakatos writes in his book, when he says that he is ready to agree with Galileo and he's ready to agree with Bellarmino Cardinal if they agree under some modest assumptions, that both predictions might be wrong, but actually, you know, dealing with science intuitively somehow improve our chances of getting closer to the truth.
I have a question. Namely, what we call random. Let us imagine, according to the discussion we had yesterday, that quantum mechanics is non-local. So that we have the numbers in our experiment, we measure Stern-Gerlach experiment, mm-hmm. we have 6 ups and 7 downs,
Yeah. And
assume that it is absolutely, in a sense, correlated with something that happens in Andromeda. Mm-hmm. That if we knew what happens now in Andromeda, we would know exactly. So is it random or is it not random? Because we have to wait 2.5 million years to know what happens now in Andromeda and say a posteriori, aha, we could have known what would be the result. Would it call it deterministic? Or would you call it non-deterministic? Because from every practical point of view, these numbers are random. If I don't have any control, any information, because I have to define with what I am correlated. If I am correlated with something over which I have no information whatsoever, it is for me random. If I have, I don't know, lottery, 6 numbers, and someone says there is a family with 6 children whose age is exactly in the lottery, but I have no access to it, and I don't know which family should I choose to cross the numbers, it is for me random. So, you know, the theoretical non-randomness, when I have to either wait 2 million years to know that it was not random, or I have no access whatsoever how to choose with what it is correlated, it is random for me. Even though theoretically it is deterministic, but if I have no access to it, I would call it random.
Okay.
I would like to ask what definition of randomness should we accept or adopt?
So, you know, obviously from the perspective of the definition I use, this situation you provided is not random. Because because there is this here, that was this definition of this call, right?
Yeah, I know.
So I would say like this, there's a matter of assumption, because you know, if you have another source that comes from another part of the universe that subjects to very fundamental laws of physics that we don't know yet, and it's ontologically random, then you may check this. At least in principle and at least in future. I'm not saying that that's the level of philosophy and practice. I agree with you that, you know,
that how you can check it. If I give you 5, 7, 17, is it random or is it not random?
No, but this is a problem. Actually, you have the same with computer science. You know that you cannot prove there is this Kolmogorov problem, that you cannot prove the random that the sequence is random. Actually, this pile was an example of that, right? So I'm saying like this: if you have this situation that you describe. So locally, if they are correlated classically, right? Then I have to admit, you really, from practical purpose, you cannot check it. Right? But I still believe that there are inferences that are very indirect, like GPS from Einstein general relativity. So maybe you would find mathematics, like this category theory, that would say that this situation that you describe require in nature some extra, it's more natural or more likely or more consistent in the Copernicus sense, that these situations require some sort of, I don't know, even not in the set theory, but something that is wrong. But I say I can't prove it. And frankly speaking, it's always that we have to live with the finite resources. So this is very interesting problem, because it relates to, you pointed out a very important question. And an important question is that we have finite resources. So anything that we can describe, or anything that we can predict, is obviously restricted to space and time of our life and energy and so on and so forth. So there might be even, I think that's a wide idea, there might be even this Gödel, you had discussed it yesterday actually, with my father.
Discussion.
With my father.
Yes.
Because after your discussion, we had a very hot few minutes.
Solve this mystery.
So obviously there is this Gödel problem, right? That you might not even imagine, right? What is behind the resources and the universe. But always there is a question. Are you already on the boundary that you couldn't imagine? Or still you can make a little step forward? And that's my answer. I couldn't give anything more.
Maybe I'd like to comment on that. Suppose that we have the following situation, okay? We have lots of galaxies, Andromedas, that we measure here, okay? What you said, random from galaxy 1, random from galaxy 2, then random from galaxy 3. In your terms, suppose that we have this lottery, and you select some numbers, okay, families or whatever. But you look at it, and the data tells you that there are some coincidences, that there is some kind of set of numbers which always falls in when you select them. So cannot be that there are some global correlations which influence our measurement here, and we can somehow realize that these other patches statistically influence our measurement here, and we can then get some observational quantity which could give us this piece of information.
So,
because you said about one, I'm extending this into many patches, okay? Many patches of the universe, and all they influence us here, and then we can say statistically, okay, we have 1, 7, 17, and so on, and the same family wins, okay? Always wins because they have. So we can then say, okay, there are some correlations with all these regions.
Yes. So I'm not astrophysicist, and I'm not working with, you know, I'm closer to physics, quantum physics, and computer science than to cosmology. But yes, but it goes both ways, because the one argument is, as you said, that's fantastic, because you could see that something, the origin of the universe, if there was one, because we know that there might be, but suppose that the big one, we would say, yes, there are some correlations. But another argument would be like this, that, and this is, I understand, this is Anton Seligman's idea, which is the following, that you say, it's very unlikely, it's maybe likely what you said, right? But it's very unlikely that you have it, you know, that these parts are very correlated. So the idea is like this. You may, it's what is likely, what is not, put it aside, right? But the idea is, okay, we kind of make more chances for randomness than not. And I understand that idea, but I absolutely agree. The problem of superdeterminism, I mentioned, I mean, you couldn't avoid it to 100%, never.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so, sorry, I have to. Do we have one comment from Professor Sapkowski, and then we have
last
to go and have some resources for the discussion?
I have a feeling that there is some solution to this problem now discussed, maybe very, very generally, and it says that both determinism and randomness are always related to a curve. Without, to some physical laws that we don't have, a theory we cannot say what is randomness, what is determinism, and according to physics, as I understand, the best definition of determinism is such that the phase trajectory do not intersect, but this means that we must have a theory which says what is the state of space, and we must have, according to the theory, dynamics, which tells us that how trajectories evolve, and it comes about that they do not intersect. So in this case, whether to know the dynamics, whether we must know local conditions, or we should know what occurs in distant galaxies, is an independent question, because it depends on the concrete theory and concrete dynamics in this theory. But without knowing that the theory, the definition of state and the dynamics, we cannot just by experiment distinguish between deterministic processes and purely random processes. But experimentally, they are indistinguishable.
But you know, I agree with you, but that always is the theory, but it's what we discuss now, I think, is which theory is more likely, whatever it means. Which theory is better in proper sense, which we can falsify better, and which passes more tests. But I agree with you, and I would say what Imre Nagatov said, which he wrote in his book, the sentence that he absolutely would agree with Galileo, if only he agreed that maybe from the perspective of God, the real nature looks completely different, and we have only some vague picture of it. But he would also agree with his opponent, if his opponent, the opponent would say that we have this intuitive hope to be closer and closer to the truth. So that's a very basic, and I agree with you, it's always about the assumption of some theory, which we falsify in the proper sense.
Last word.
It seems to me that if we discuss this problem randomness, we should clearly distinct description from reality information we get from laboratories. This is very important. For example, we know that in fact from experience from laboratories that there is some intimate peace cooperation between deterministic and non-deterministic. For example, we know that we have any reasonable description should contain constants of nature. This is not deterministic, but this number of this ratio proton electron mass. So maybe that this peace cooperation is something like trade-off. Nature produced some weak randomness, but having a very deterministic, strong deterministic foundation. And this is very strange for me. But in this context, the condition between the subjective probability and objective probability, which was very hot in times of Jane's approach, Jane's philosophy was starting from laboratory data and produce some optimal description. But my final conclusion is that maybe that the concept of information should be seriously extended. We know that we have some hierarchy of information, statistical, topological, many, many levels. But now we know that the constant number of nature is deterministic. It may be that we need some, we include information which will be more universal than probability itself. Maybe that probability, this is not new, this is not my revelation, but that information is more fundamental concept than probability. Then probability should be extracted from information, yes. Not
I think that what you said is in the spirit of this motto I had, that Professor Heller says that loss of probability are loss.
Yes.
And the fact that they are loss is in this fundamental basis of information already.
It's constraints. There is this constraint on the probability of.
Okay, so let me make the cut here.